So guys, here I'm going to start the meeting. So guys, I hope you can see my screen. Okay. So guys, in this training program, we are going to discuss about ASP.NET MVC5 with Angular 2 plus Angular 4 development. So now guys, right now, if you are planning to develop a web application using .NET framework stack. So right now people are using the Angular 2 as a supporting framework with ASP.NET MVC, so that you can develop rich user interface for your application, and you can, you know, handle the so many things on the client side. I don't know, guys, frankly speaking, people are using the Angular in place of jQuery for handling so many client side manipulation. So here we will discuss about the MVC5 and Angular 2 plus 4 development training program. So guys, here before going to start the class, I'm going to introduce myself. So my name is Shailin Chauhan. I'm an author, architect, corporate trainer. I'm also awarded as Microsoft MVP in the field of Visual Studio Technology. I'm the founder and CEO of .NET X Innovation Private Limited. And I have around 9 years of experience of web development and teaching. And I have delivered so many training in corporate, like Omnigent, IBM, and other companies as well. And I have written the most popular free e-books on various topics like TypeScript training book, Node.js interview question answer and book, Angular.js interview question answer book, ASP.NET MVC interview question answer book, and Link interview question answer book. And all these books you can download from our website as free of cost. So I hope guys you can hear me properly. If somebody is facing the issue, please inform me through the chat window, because now I'm going to start the session. Please respond to the chat window. Am I audible to you? Okay. So guys, here, as per the plan, here I'm going to discuss about the ASP.NET web form versus ASP.NET MVC. How the ASP.NET MVC is different from the web form. And you know, what are the advantages of ASP.NET MVC we have. Then I will discuss about the Angular and how the Angular 2 is different from Angular 1. So all these things we will discuss here. So let's start with how the ASP.NET MVC is different from the ASP.NET web form. So now guys, the ASP.NET web form follow the event driven element model, because in ASP.NET web form, everything we write with respect to an event. But in ASP.NET MVC, we do not follow this model. We follow here MVC pattern. So everything is here as an action. So when you're clicking on a button, so for handling the button click, you have to write an action in the controller. And the benefit of using the MVC pattern is we are following the way of SOC, separation of concern. Because you know guys, if you're talking about the web application development, the main concern for developing a web application are we have data. And data part we are managing here using model, and we have here logic, and the logic part we are managing here using controller, and we have user interface, and the user interface we are managing here using view. So ultimately using MVC, you are going to handle your web application main concern separately. That's why it supports SOC. And the second point here, in web form, we have server controls, and these server controls we can do drag and drop on our ASPX page. But in ASP.NET MVC, we don't have the server controls. We have the HTML helpers, and HTML helpers are, you know, just like we have the pure HTML input control in our HTML. And HTML helpers are, you know, very lightweight as compared to the server controls, because they does not support the view state. And the next point is here, in WebForm, we have the support for WebForm view engine. So, you know, the guys, when you're talking about the WebForm view engine, in case of WebForm view engine, we follow the traditional XML based syntax. But in ASP.NET MVC, we have the supports for two view engine. It means you can follow the two markup syntax. Either you can follow the web forms, either you can follow the razor syntax. But you know guys, if you are planning to develop a ASP.NET MVC application from scratch, so the recommended view engine is razor. Here the ASP.NET MVC team is supporting the web form because of backward compatibility. Because it might be the case you have an application in ASP.NET 3.5 or like 4.0. But the new module element you want to do using ASP.NET MVC with Razor. So if there is, so the new module element you can do using ASP.NET MVC with Razor. So because of that, they are supporting the web form as well. So in your existing application, we can easily integrate the ASP.NET MVC style of developing the new module, and there will be no breaking changes. So here we will follow the ASP.NET MVC with Razor. We are not going to follow the web form as a markup syntax. I know guys, when you're talking about the markup syntax, so the both are the server side markup syntax. These are not the client side. If you're talking about the client side, so in that case, we will use the Angular. I know guys, moreover, for the state maintenance in ASP.NET WebForm, you know, we have a view state, and the view state we use for passing the data on the same page. I know guys, the view state always is stored as a hidden field on our ASPX page. But you know guys, in ASP.NET MVC, we don't have any support for view state. We have the view state alternative, and these are view data and view back. So view data and view back are alternative to the view state, but these never stored as a hidden field. They just behave as a normal variable. So as soon as your page will render, they will be garbage collected by the GC. Moreover guys, in web form, if you want to pass the data from one page to another page, we use session. And you know guys, session will be available on the server side till the user is logged in, or like whatever its default time. So by default time is here 20 minutes. But in ASP.NET MVC, we have session alternative as well. And a session alternative is temp data. So temp data we use in ASP.NET MVC if you want to pass any message, any information from one page to another page. Let's say you want to share the information like your page has been updated successfully, like a single object you want to pass. So in that case, the temp data will help you, because the temp data is just like a temporary session. So as soon as you will read the value on the target page, it will be garbage collected. But in case of session, in MVC, session is recommended to use, you can say, to store the user specific information. Like if you want to store the user logged in username, or like user logged in user login details. Because you know guys, the logged in user details we have to access across the application. So better, and the, you know, the recommended is session. So at that place, don't use temp data. We should use session for storing the user specific information. And guys, if you have any queries so far, you can ask now. So what are the point I have covered so far regarding all these points? You can ask the query. Yogesh, do you have any query? And guys, if you're talking about the view data and the view back, view data is available from ASP.NET MVC 2. And viewBag is available from ASP.NET MVC 3. And viewBag is a dynamic property, and internally it's wrapping the view data. So in case of view data, if you want to access the value in C# code, So you have to do typecasting. But in case of viewback, if you are going to access the value within the C#, then you don't need to do the typecasting because it is a dynamic one. Yeah, guys, you can also implement the caching in ASP.NET MVC as well. So we have here output cache attribute using which you can cache the response of any action in ASP.NET MVC. Yeah, guys, HTML helpers are just like the server controls. And actually, if you're talking about the technically, so these are the extension method. So these are the extension method of HTML helper class. In MVC, there is a HTML helper class. So these are the extension method for that class. And you know, guys, if you're talking about the any extra control, you can use the, you know, Telerik toolkit. You can use the DevX as well. So these companies provide so many MVC control you can use. And guys, when you're talking about for rendering the partial view, so if you want to render the static partial view like footer and like header, then you should use html.partial method. If you want to render anything dynamically, then use html.action method. Simple. So I hope we have done so far. And if you're talking about the next point, so now guys, in web form, we have file based URL mapping. If you're talking about the URL generation pattern in web form, so we have like domain.com/aboutus.aspx. But in ASP.NET MVC, we have the route based URL mapping. And this route we define in our route config. So in route config, we specify a pattern for controller and for the action. So in the URL, we have only controller name and the action name. And the action logically will decide which view has to be rendered. So there is a route based URL mapping. And this is a logical mapping between an action and between a physical view file on our machine. I don't know, guys, in web form, we have the user control. If you want to reuse a particular, you know, process, like particular task, so in that case, we create the user control in web form. But in ASP.NET MVC, the same thing we can achieve using partial views. So like suppose you want to implement the login process, like sign up process, like you can say if you want to display the, you know, the number of categories everywhere. So these type of things we can implement with the help of partial views here. I know, guys, moreover, the ASP.NET web form is not open source, but MVC is open source. I know, guys, the benefit of open source is the open source softwares are free to use. And the second thing is you can customize the open source framework and the softwares as per the requirement. I know, guys, in the today class, I'm just giving you the, you know, the introduction of each and everything. Because in a one day, it is not possible to cover each and everything. All the topics we will discuss in detail here. So don't worry, all the topics we will discuss in the separate session. So right now, I'm just comparing the features of WebForm and ASP.NET MVC so that you can relate the things. What are the alternative we have in ASP.NET MVC? Anyway, the difference between the open source and not open source updates are the open source updates. You can customize as per your requirement, and based on the any open source software, you can develop your own as well. If you see, jQuery is an open source library, and based on the jQuery library, we have so many others library as well in the market. Like we have Bootstrap, we have jQuery UI, and we have other third party library and plugin as well. So guys, do you have any other query? So guys, overall, if you are talking about the advantage of ASP.NET MVC, so these are the advantages of ASP.NET MVC. The first thing is it supports suppression of concern. So it supports SOC, because when you're talking about the web application development, so in web application development, we have mainly three things. We have presentation logic, we have data, we have the user interface. And all these three things we are going to handle here using ASP.NET MVC. Yeah, Mudit, what is your query? Mudit, I told here if you are talking about the all the topic in detail, in one day it is not possible. On routing, we have the separate class. So don't worry, all the things we will cover in upcoming classes. If you're talking about, you know, the syntax of web form and razor. So web form syntax, you know, it is just like the XML based syntax. And it is not, you know, so clear as we have the razor. So in ASP.NET MVC, the recommended the syntax is razor. So you should follow the razor syntax, not the web form, because razor syntax is easy to understand and easy to write as well. Anyway, the next thing is here, extensible and pluggable. So now guys, ASP.NET MVC is open source, so you can extend its features. It means you can customize it as per your requirement, and even you can plug it with existing ASP.NET web form application as well. So if you have an application in ASP.NET 3.5 and 4.0, so the new development you can easily do by plugging the ASP.NET MVC module in your application. There will be no breaking change between both the application. And now guys, this lightweight as well, because we don't have here, you know, the view state support. We don't have here, you know, the server controls. We don't have here, you know, unnecessary page lifecycle event. And we have the, you know, the session alternative as well. So here, whatever the things takes the time while loading the web page in ASP.NET web form. So those things are not available in ASP.NET MVC. So that's it is lightweight. And if you are talking about the performance of MVC as compared to the web form, so MVC application are almost 2 times faster than web form application. Moreover, the MVC will support test driven element as well. So now guys, in test driven element, instead of writing the code after the requirement gathering and analysis, we directly write the unit test cases. So obviously when you will write the unit test case first time, it will be failed because you don't have any code. So after writing the failed unit test case, we have to write the sufficient code so that unit test case will be passed here. Then after passing the unit test case, we will do the refactoring of our code. So this is the test driven element you can follow with ASP.NET MVC. And the next thing is here we have URL routing, and even we have the better support for other open sources as well, like jQuery, Angular, Knockout, React. So other open sources we can use with ASP.NET MVC in better way as compared to the web form. You know guys, here I'm not saying like you cannot use the Angular, React and Knockout with web form. Definitely you can use there as well. But here we have the better support from web form. And the most important thing is whatever the security features we have in ASP.NET web form, the same features are available in ASP.NET MVC as well, because it supports all the ASP.NET framework features. If you're talking about the better support means if you are going to integrate the jQuery with web form. So now guys, in jQuery, we find out a particular control ID. So sometimes it is very difficult to find out that control ID, because in web form, we have the ID generation like CTRL100 underscore, then content placeholder ID, then we have that server control ID. Sometimes it is very difficult to guess the generated ID for that control. But in MVC, we don't have such type of things. So there are so many things in web form which are not easy to predict as compared to the ASP.NET MVC. In MVC, the things are easy to, you know, integrate as compared to the web form. Anything else you want to ask? And actually here, we will start the Angular 2 and Angular 4. I'm not going to cover here Angular 1, because the Angular 2 is entirely rewrite of Angular 1. And to learn the Angular 2, guys, it is not mandated to learn the Angular JS 1. And guys, if you're talking about the testing framework, so we will cover here like how to write the unit test cases using XUnit and the MS test framework. So I will show you how you can write the unit test cases in ASP.NET MVC. guys, here about the MVC, I will tell you in detail, like what is the role of model, view and controller. Because right now I'm just giving you the, you know, the overview of both the technology, and I will show you hands-on as well so that you can understand. So about MVC, I will tell you in the next class, what is the role of model, what is the role of view and the controller. Okay guys, now guys, let's try to understand the Angular part. What is Angular? So now guys, if you are talking about the Angular, so Angular.js 1 was released in 2012, and it is released by the Google. And you know guys, the Angular.js 1 was written to manipulate the client side thing easily as compared to the, you know, the jQuery. And even the Angular.js 1 allow us to follow the MVW pattern, so that we can manipulate the things on the client side easily as compared to the jQuery. Yeah, vision that you can include the MVC5 pages with your existing ASP.NET form application, and it will work without any issue. But you have to do some changes in the web.config, and you have to do some changes, you know, to support the MVC routing and other things. Anything else you want to ask? So guys, can we go ahead? Yeah, guys, please respond. Can we go ahead? Okay, so now guys, if you're talking about the Angular 2, so Angular 2 was released in September 2016. I know guys, so far we have only July, so Angular 2 is not a 1 year old framework. So far in September it will be 1 year old framework, and within 1 year we have the another version of Angular, that is Angular 4. But you know guys, the Angular 4 is just successor of Angular 2. So whatever the concept we have in Angular 2, same concept we have in Angular 4 as well. But they have introduced some new features. That's it. So for learning the Angular 4, you don't need to learn all the things again as we have in Angular 1 and Angular 2. So now guys, if you are talking about the Angular 2, so Angular 2 is modern, faster and highly scalable framework as compared to the Angular.js 1. And guys, the Angular 2 is a one framework for building web application, mobile application and desktop application as well. So if you're planning to develop all these three types of application using Angular 2, you can develop easily. And now guys, Angular 2 is not update to Angular 1. It is a complete rewrite. So to learn Angular 2, it is not mandatory to learn the Angular 1, because in Angular 1 we have different style of writing the code, and in Angular 2 we have different style of writing the code. I know guys, the Angular 2 is actually written in TypeScript. So when we will write our Angular 2 and Angular 4 code, we will follow the TypeScript syntax. So to get a start with Angular 2, you must know the TypeScript. So guys, in this training section, I will cover the TypeScript as well, so that you will feel comfortable how to write the code in Angular application. So don't worry about that. Moreover, if you are, you know, from the background of C sharp, Java and the PHP, so you already know the object oriented programming language concept like classes, interfaces, methods and the generics. So now guys, these concepts are not available in JavaScript. So if you will follow the TypeScript as a programming language in Angular 2, so it will be very easy for you to adopt the Angular 2, because in TypeScript we have the same concept. We have the classes in TypeScript, we have the interfaces in TypeScript, we have the object oriented programming language features as well. So for the C-sharp, Java and the, you know, the object oriented programming languages developer, it is easy to adopt the Angular 2 if they are using the TypeScript as a programming language. But in Angular.js 1, the things are entirely different, because there you have to write the JavaScript based code. So JavaScript style is entirely different. Moreover, in Angular 2, we have the web component based architecture. I know guys, if you're talking about the today web development style, so the people are are following the web component based architecture. And if you're talking about the web component based architecture, let's take an example. So now guys, suppose you want to develop a login process. So now guys, if you will develop the login process in .NET, let's say in ASP.NET MVC you're developing. So generally what we do, we write the presentation logic in presentation layer, we write the business logic in business layer, we write the data access logic in that layer. So our code will be, you know, separated in three layers. But if you're talking about the web component based architecture, for the login process, we will create a component. We will create a folder with the name, like let's say login, and that login folder, all the presentation logic, all the services, all the HTML, all the, you know, the style sheet, we will put in that folder. That folder will behave as a, will act as a web component. The benefit of following the web component based architecture is, if you want to reuse that login process with other project as well, so you have to just copy that entire folder and entire login functionality you have copied from your code. But in case of .NET application, you have to copy the code, some code you have to copy from the presentation layer, some code you have to copy from the bell layer, some code you have to copy from the dell layer, you have to copy the style sheet as well. So sometimes it is very difficult, like what the style CSS we have written for handling the login process, what are the method we are calling in bell and the dell. So things are not easy to copy, to plug and play in ASP.NET MVC and any MPA based application. So Angular 2 help us to develop the web component, and these web component we can easily plug to any other project. It is exactly same way as we have, you know, in a smartphone, the people are using the USB charging. So the USB charger are same for any phone. It doesn't matter whether you are using the Samsung, Nokia, Oppo, any phone you can use, and the charger are same. So you have to just plug and play and your mobile is ready for charging. Same thing you can do here. Just create a web component for login process, and that login web component you can copy from one project to another project, and in the other project is ready to use. You don't need to do anything. The web component, guys, will contain the presentation logic as well. And you know, guys, in Angular, behind the scene, we have a REST service. And that REST service code, obviously, you have to, you know, copy in other REST service. It might be the case, the same REST service you are using. Anything else, guys, you want to ask? Yogesh, here, if you are comparing the Angular 2 and ASP.NET MVC5, actually, the Angular things are going to, you know, executed on the client side only. Sometimes we need to develop the project where, you know, we have the security in case in the prospective of data. So in that case, Angular will not help you. Let's say if you want to develop a bank website where data is more secure. So in that case, we need a technology where the things are going to executed on the server side, not on the client side. But if you are going to develop a simple application like any e-commerce website like Flipkart, Paytm, or any service-based application, obviously in that case, Angular will help you, because the maximum thing we can do on the client side and for, you know, the backend, we can use the REST service for doing the things. The authentication part I will cover in this session, don't worry. I will tell you how you can implement the authentication in Angular 2 and Web API as well. So we will implement here token-based security between Angular and Web API. And even I will tell you how you can protect your Angular roots using the, you know, the root guard in Angular 2. Anything else, guys, you want to ask? I said, if you're talking about the mobile apps development, so for the mobile apps development based on Angular, we have others framework as well. Like we have Ionic, we have, you know, native script, So using Ionic, you can develop the cross-platform hybrid app. So your single code base will run on iOS, Android, and Windows Phone as well. And the same thing we have in native script as well. So these are the two framework based on the Angular. So these two framework will facilitate to us to develop the cross-platform mobile apps. Mohan, if you're talking about the security, I said here, the maximum things we are computing on the client side, but when we will post the data on the server side, then on the API side, like web API, we will validate that data. So on the server side, before going to insert the things into a database, we will validate the things. So it's not the case we don't have the security. On the side of REST service, we will validate all the user input. Simple. Kapil, here we are going to start the batch. You know, from today onwards, we have started the batch actually. It is a instructor lead training program. So you can ask your queries and we will give you the answer. Guys, here, if you are going to use only Angular for the front end element, you can use Angular as well for the front end element. And guys, to understand the Angular MVC, I'm giving the example. You know, guys, Angular you can use as a independent framework as well for building your web application. As a backend, you just need a REST service. And it is exactly same way, you know, if you're talking about the Bollywood. In Bollywood, sometimes two actors, you know, are in the same movie. Let's say take the example of Akshay Kumar and the Salman Khan. So sometimes both the actors are the part of the same movie, but when both actors are coming in the same movie, so only one actor will play the role of lead actor and other actor will play the role of supporting actor. And if you will see, both the actors have their independent movie as well. So Salman Khan can create a independent movie as an independent lead actor. Akshay Kumar can also play a movie as an independent actor. Same thing we have with MVC and Angular as well. If we are clubbing the Angular with MVC, like with PHP, like with Angular, with, you know, Java. So always Angular 2 will play the role of supporting framework. And the lead framework would be here MVC only. But you can use the Angular 2 as a independent framework as well. There is no issue. So obviously when we will club the Angular with MVC, so all the Angular features we cannot use with MVC because we are using it as a supporting framework. And in simple language, right now people are using Angular with MVC, with PHP and with Java in place of jQuery. Because in jQuery, we have to write a lot of code, but in Angular, we don't need to write so much code. So here the things are simple and easy to, you know, develop the things as compared to the jQuery and others JavaScript library and framework. I hope guys, now you can understand which one to use. At Deepak, you can use SOAP as well. But the recommended is here REST service, because in REST service we, you know, transfer the data in JSON format and JSON take the, you know, the less space, or you can say the less, you know, the bandwidth when you are going to travel it. But in the SOAP base, we have the data in XML. So data takes, you know, the large space. And in case of SOAP, always you have to do, you know, the serialization and the deserialization for handling the things. So the JSON data is easy to consume in Angular because JSON is in itself is a JavaScript object notation. So here JSON is recommended, but sometimes you can use SOAP as well. That's not the case. Yeah guys, obviously the Angular is cross browser compatible. You can run it everywhere like jQuery. Anugada Ganesh, the session would be here of 2 hours, 7 to 9. Fungus, obviously the session is, you know, paid, it's not free. Anything else, guys, you want to ask? And you guys, the last point here, the Angular 2 supports hierarchical dependency injection. If you're talking about the hierarchy, let's say we have a parent class and we have a child class, and we have, if we are injecting a dependency at the parent level, so that dependency will available on the child level as well. So this is the hierarchical dependency. But in Angular JS 1, you have to inject the dependency separately at the parent level and separately at the child level. But in Angular 2, they have improved the dependency injection concept. So just inject the dependency on the parent level, it will be available on the child level as well. And guys, TypeScript is a superset of JavaScript. So what are the features we have in JavaScript? So these are available in TypeScript as well. And TypeScript, if you will use, it will give you the experience of object-oriented programming languages like C# and the Java. So it is easy to adopt the TypeScript style if you are from the background of Java and the C#. Yeah, guys, all the sessions are recorded. You will get the recording of each and every session. For the installation, I will tell you in the upcoming classes. Don't worry. Anything else, guys, you want to ask? And like, guys, here in a quick way, I'm just sharing the difference between Angular 2 and Angular 1. So this is the table to understand the difference between these two. You know, guys, in Angular 2, we have the components. But in Angular 1, we have the controller and scope. So for doing the same thing, we create the controller and scope in Angular 1. And if you are taking the Angular 2, in Angular 2, we have improved the dependency injection part, because now here we have the hierarchical dependency. But in Angular 1, we have the supports for DI, but we don't have the support for hierarchical dependency. Simple. Then in Angular 2, we have the web component based architecture, but in Angular 1, we don't have the web component based architecture. And Angular 2 is written by focusing the mobile devices as well, so that you can develop the mobile website, you can develop the mobile apps as well. But Angular 1 was not written to focus the mobile development. Moreover, in Angular 2, you can follow either JavaScript, ES5 and ES6 style, TypeScript and Dart language style. But in Angular 1, we can follow the only JavaScript and the Dart language style. And otherwise, in Angular 2, we have Angular CLI, command language interface. And using the Angular CLI, we can scaffold the code. We can generate the code here automatically. And even we can run our Angular application as well. So many things are automated for building, creating our Angular 2 application. But in Angular 1, we does not have support for Angular CLI. Anyway, after this slide, I will start the coding part. Don't worry. This is a large slide. Moreover, guys, in Angular 2, if you are talking about the service creation, so class is only way to create a service in Angular 2. But in Angular 1, we have the different methods for creating the services like factory, service, provider, value, and the constant. I know, guys, we have a major difference between Angular 2 and Angular 1, that is, Angular 2, you can run on client side as well as server side. If you're planning to run the Angular 2 on the server side, so you can use Node.js, you can use .NET Core. So using these two frameworks, you can run the Angular 2 on the server side, but Angular 1, we can run only client side. You cannot run the Angular 1 on server side. So these are the, you know, the differences between Angular 2 and Angular 1. So guys, if you have any query regarding the Angular 2 and Angular 1 comparison, please ask. So you can see here to learn Angular 2, it is not mandatory to know the Angular 1 because both are different framework. You know, guys, when you're talking about the Angular 2 on the server side, so Angular 2 will play the role of only a view engine. As we have, you know, .NET as a runtime environment and ASP.NET MVC for the web element. Same way, Node.js will be the runtime environment and Angular 2 will be for the web element framework. All the things. Anything else, guys, you want to ask? Now, guys, Angular 2 and React both are different. React is a library, so React will provide you limited functionality. Angular 2 is a complete framework for building the things. So if you're using Angular 2, you don't need to learn, or don't need to use any other library and framework. But in case of React, if you have to learn other library and framework as well. React cannot do its job entirely. So we have to use their React router, we have to use their Redux, we have to use others framework as well for developing a React-based application. But in Angular, Angular is sufficient to learn for developing the complete web application from start to end. Yeah, guys, both are open source. Angular is open source, React is open source, MVC is also open source. All the frameworks are open source. About ES5 and ES6, we have only, you know, some features differences. In ES6, we have some new features which are not available in ES5. It is exactly the same. We have some new features in MVC5 which are not available in MVC4. About the ES6 and the TypeScript, I will discuss in TypeScript class. So guys, here let's see how to create a MVC project here. I'm just showing the way. Then I will come to the, you know, the question again. In the last of the class, I will take their question. So guys, here I'm just using the Visual Studio 2017 for the development here. So I hope you can see. Guys, if you are using the Mac, so in case of Mac, you cannot use the ASP.NET MVC5 for the development. On the Mac, you can do the development only for ASP.NET Core. So guys, I hope you can see my Visual Studio screen. Can you see? Okay. So let's see how to create a project using the Visual Studio 2017. So here I'm just going to create a new project here. So just create a new project. So here within the, you know, Visual C Sharp, we have the option for web. And here just select the ASP.NET web application here. And here just specify the location where you want to store the project. Let's say I'm going to store it in my code folder and in weekdays. And you know, guys, here I will show you how you can club the Angular with MVC. So I'm creating a web application with Angular. Now here, you know, guys, these are the available template you can use for creating the different project. All these template I will explain in next class. Right now I'm just selecting the empty one for the MVC. So in empty template, we have only the basic setting. We have the basic, the DLL references to run a simple ASP.NET MVC application. So we will not have any unnecessary DLL reference here for creating the project. So let's create a project here. So it's creating a project for web application and Angular. So now guys, if you will see here, it's created a simple, you know, the folder structure here. So first of all, let's understand the folder structure as created by the Visual Studio here. So now guys, if you will see here, we have here app underscore data folder. So this folder you can use if you want to put the database file in this folder. Like, you know, sometimes we need to put the database at the project level. So in this app data folder, you can put the MDO file here. But you know guys, practically we don't use the app underscore data folder because we have the separate database server. So using the connection string for that separate server, we access that. Guys, if you don't have the Visual Studio 2017, you can use the Visual Studio 2015 as well. There is no issue. The same option you will get in 15 as well. And you know guys, you have to just install the community edition because community edition is free to use for the personal purpose. And you know guys, we have here app underscore start folder as well. So this app underscore start folder is available from ASP.NET MVC4. Before ASP.NET MVC4, we don't have this folder. So in app underscore start folder, we put all the configuration file which are required, you know, whatever the, you know, configuration setting you want to apply on the application level. So those configuration file we will add here. So generally we add here like route config, bundle config, web API config, and the filter config, because all these things we want to apply on the application level. And if you will see in the route config file, we have a default route for running our ASP.NET MVC application. And you know guys, to run your ASP.NET MVC application, you must have at least one root in register root method. If you will not have any root in your route config file, then you cannot able to serve any web page in your ASP.NET MVC application. So it is mandatory to add a root in your application. And you know guys, about routing, we have a separate class. So on the routing, we will do the detailed discussion in the routing class. So right now I'm just not going to discuss about them more in routing. I'm just telling you the basic things here. And if you will see, this is the default option here. So now guys, as we have, you know, the setting for setting the home page in ASP.NET Web Form, or you can say for setting the start page for the application. So if you want to set the start page for the application, so your controller name should be here home, and the action name should be here index. So every time when you will run the project, it will look for the home controller, it will look for the index action within the home controller. So these are the setting for setting the home page for our ASP.NET MVC application here. So this is exactly same as we have, we do the, you know, the right click on any ASPX page and we can set the start page. Same way we can do the setting here. I will share the link for downloading the Visual Studio, don't worry. And now guys, if you will see, we have a option here, ignore root. So objective of ignore root method is, sometimes we have, you know, some resources files. Let's say you are developing a multilingual website. So in that case, we create the resource file for the Hindi language, Japanese language, for English language. So if those resources, you don't want to make the part of the routing, so those resource files we can ignore using the this statement symbol. So guys, anything else you want to ask? And if you will see here guys, we have controllers folder, it is empty. So in the controllers folder, we will add our controller. So let's say here I'm going to add my controller, and as per the, you know, the default home page, I will create my controller name as home, but it is not mandatory. You can change, you can create the controller with any name, but for the default value, I'm creating the controller with the name home here. So just to right click on the controllers folder, I'm going to add a new controller. So now it is asking for which controller you want to create. I'm going to create here empty one, because we are not going to auto generate the code. We will write the entire code by ourselves. So that's why I'm using here MVC5 controller MD1. Now here it is asking for the controller name. So when you are giving the controller name, let's say I'm giving my controller name as home. And I know guys, every controller in ASP.NET MVC must have the controller word as a suffix. It is mandatory as per the framework rule. Now just click on the add button. So it will create a home controller using the scaffolding. You can see here, we are getting the option for scaffolding. And you know guys, if you're talking about the scaffolding, so scaffolding is a code generation technique. If you want to generate the code in .NET, Angular, Java, and the PHP, every framework nowadays is using the scaffolding. The scaffolding is a code generation technique used by the ASP.NET MVC5 for code generation, simple. And you can see we have here models folder. Models folder is empty. If you want to create the object in your MVC application, so those object we will create here, simple. Then you will see we have here a views folder. Views folder is empty here. So in the models, I can create a object here. Let's say I'm creating a object. So let's say we want to create a login page. So I'm going to create a login class here. Login model I'm creating here. And the login model class, I will add two properties. So it will be here a string, let's say user name. I'm adding one more property with the name password. Password here. So this is the model class I have created. I don't know guys, based on this model class, I will create my login page here, simple. So now guys, if you will see corresponding to home controller, we have a folder in views file. And this folder has been created when I have added this home controller. So now guys, in ASP.NET MVC application, all the views file we will add in this view folder. And if you will see in this view folder, we have a web.config file. So what is the role of this web.config file? So actually in this web.config file, we define the setting for all the views file which we are going to add in this folder. So you can see here, we have a setting for the Razor view engine. And if you will see, we have the commonly used namespaces. So instead of adding these namespaces with the help of using a statement on each and every view file, the better way is just add all the namespaces here, and all these namespaces will available on each and every view file. And even guys, further we will create our own custom helper as well. So when we will create our own custom helper, and when we want to use those custom helper on each and every view page, so that custom helper namespace I will add here, so that helper we can access on the each and every view page in my ASP.NET MVC application. I don't know guys, if you will see, we have here one more web.config at the root level. So you might be thinking how the root level web.config is different from the view folder level web.config. The difference between these two is the view folder level web.config setting will be applicable only to views folder, but the root level web.config file setting will be applicable all the folder in our application. So if you want to apply the application level setting, like you want to define the database connection string, like the security, like form authentication, window authentication, even if you want to add the module and handler. So those setting we will define at the root level web.config file. But in the view folder level web.config file, we will define the setting related to views only. I know guys, if you will see here, we have a global.asx file as well. So this global.asx file is exactly same as we have in web form. I don't know guys, it is mandatory to call all the app underscore start configuration file method in this application underscore start. You can see here, I'm calling the route config register routes method here, because this is the method which will be executed only one time when your ASP.NET MVC application will start on the IIS. So whatever the, you know, the application wide setting you want to apply in your project, so those setting, those configuration method you have to call in this application underscore start method. So here, if you want to add like the WP config, bundle config, and like filter config, all the configuration file method we will call in this application underscore start method. I know guys, here we have here one more configuration file, that is packages.config. So the role of this packages.config file is, it is actually containing the information about the NuGet packages. You know guys, if you remember the days of ASP.NET 2.0, like 3.5, if at that time, if you want to upgrade your project from ASP.NET 2.0 to 3.5, so we do the, you know, manual update. And even if you want to include the third party, you know, library and framework. So that third party library and framework DLL we have to download manually, and that we have to put in the bin folder, and we have to do the necessary setting in the web.config as well. But after the introduction of NuGet, if you want to use any third party framework, like any .NET based library like entity framework, web API, you have to just run the NuGet package command. So there is a official website for, you know, for downloading the NuGet packages. I'm just sharing the my. So here there is an official website for the NuGet, NuGet.org. Can you see my, you know, the browser screen? So from here you can search for any NuGet package. Let's say if you want to search for entity framework. So we can search for entity framework. So there is a listing for entity framework, and this package we can install for the entity framework. So you have to run this command using the, you know, NuGet package manager console. So in the VS Code, either run this command using the package manager console, either in VS Visual Studio, we have the directly option for installing the NuGet packages. So we have the manage NuGet packages option here, and we can make a search for entity framework. Like you can see, we have the package listing for entity framework. So just click on this install button. It will automatically add all the setting for entity framework to be used in your project. So now guys, now it is easy to add the new library and even to upgrade your existing project from MVC3 to MVC4 and MVC5. So you have to just run some commands using the package manager console. So if you want to find out like which version of MVC your project is using, which version of entity framework your project is using, just open the packages.config file and you can check the things here. Simple. So guys, do you have any query so far? I have explained the entire folder structure. Guys, here if you are talking about the scaffolding, so scaffolding is a code generation technique. And every framework nowadays is using the scaffolding. So scaffolding you will find in Angular as well, in Java as well, and you know, in .NET as well. Anything else, guys, you want to ask? So guys, if you have any query, please ask. If you don't have, we can proceed. No, Vijay, you don't need to specify the version number here. When you will install the NuGet package, so at that time it will give you the option which version of that framework you want to install. If you're talking about the entity framework, it is giving the version. Whether you want to install the entity framework latest version like 6.1.3, like 5.0, like 4.2. So whatever the version you will install here. So that version entry will be in packages.config, so that you can understand like which version of entity framework we are using, which version of MVC we are using. So it is having the information, all the packages version, so that you can write the code as per your version support. Simple. Guys, here we have created our MVC application using the latest version of ASP.NET MVC, that is MVC5. If you're talking about the older project, it might be the case you have a project in MVC3. So you will find here 3.x version number. If that project you want to upgrade to MVC5. So in that case, you will get the option for upgrading your MVC3 to MVC5. Simple. And whatever the, you know, the necessary setting we have to do in the web.config, it is automatically done by the package manager console. You can see for the entity framework, it's added a section here. And if you will see for the entity framework, we have an entity framework tag. So these two changes are automatically done by this NuGet package manager when I installed the entity framework into my project. Simple. So guys, anything else you want to ask? So guys, let's proceed here. Let's see how to create a view. So for the index section, I'm going to create a view. Just to right click on the index section and just use the option add view. Now I'm using here index view. I know guys, by default it will suggest the view name as we have our action name, but it is not mandatory. If you want to change the view name, you can change the view name here. So you can put here the view name as like my index. Like say I can put my view name as login. So when you will change the view name, in that case you have to specify the view name in the return view method. If the view name is matching with the index file, you don't need to tell to the return view method like which view file you want to render. But here the view name is different, so that's why you have to pass my file name, let's say login. And if you will see in the login page, we have only a heading with the name login. And if you will see, when I have added this login page, it's automatically created this shared folder. And okay, the objective of this shared folder is to put all the common files here. So now guys, here in the shared folder, we have to specify like master pages, like common error pages, like the reusable UI component. All the things we will add in the shared folder. Yeah guys, here the references are doing the same job as we have in ASP.NET Network form. So we have the bin folder as well here. If you will see here, we have the option to see the hidden folder. So we have a bin folder and all the details are the part of this bin folder. You can see. I don't know guys, so far I have not specified any database detail. So the database connections thing I will specify in my root level web.config. Here we will specify the thing. Guys, we're talking about the mean stack and ASP.NET MVC. Both the framework you can do for doing the same thing. It is exactly same thing. Some people like Java for the website element, some people like .NET for the website element, and some people like, you know, Node.js. So both are the alternative to each other. So it's up to you in which framework, in which programming language you feel comfortable. If you feel comfortable with JavaScript, then use MeanStack. If you feel comfortable with .NET and the C#, then use ASP.NET MVC. Objective of both the framework is same. Anything else you want to ask? I know guys, the connected service option I'm getting because I'm using here Visual Studio 2017. If you will use a Visual Studio 2015, you will not get this option. This is because of, you know, cloud service. Because from 2017, they are giving it the option. You know, there's so many things they have improved in the Visual Studio so that I can deploy this code on Windows very easily. Simple. Anything else you want to ask? So now guys, let's see how to create the control for login and the sign up. So here I'm going to create a simple HTML form. So just use here using, and it will be here HTML.beginForm. So now guys, this is the razor syntax to create a form tag. And here what I can do, I can put a div, and here I can create a simple text form for username. For username, just use it @html.textbox4. I know guys, here I'm using here, I'm going to create a strongly type view. If you want to make this view as strongly type, just do the thing @model, and the namespace name you have to use. So namespace would be here app angular /models, then login model, simple. And in the textbook 4, just use the thing m for model I'm using here, m.username I'm using. And look guys, about this syntax, I will explain in HTML helper class. What is the meaning of this syntax here? So right now, just think here, we are using here lambda expression. So the left hand side to this lambda operator, just refer to the method parameters, and the right hand side just refer to the method body. Using the lambda expression, I am accessing this login model class properties. So we have a detailed discussion on the lambda expression and the HTML helpers. So using the lambda expression, you can access your user model class properties. Then I can create a control for password as well, like @HTML, then password for, then use here mm.password. So this way it will create a text work for username and the password. I can put a div for the submit button as well, like input type submit, and a value would be here login. So it will be here login. Simple. So what it will do, it will create the text work for username and password and a submit button for login. Now let's run the code. Minus about the difference between textbox and textbox 4, I will tell you in HTML helper class. So far, just remember, textbox is a standard helper, and in the textbox, you don't need to pass any property reference. But textbox 4 is a, you know, it's a strongly type helper. And in textbox 4, you have to pass the property reference. I'm using here a strongly type helper because whatever the validation I will write in my login model validation class, like I will make the username as required, password as required. So those validation automatically will work on my login page as well. Simple. So for validating the user input on the client side and the server side, the strongly type helper will help you. Guys, for the submit button, we don't have any HTML helper. If you want to create your own, you can create. Because it is simple, we are not going to maintain here any state. So that's why they have not created any helper for submit button. Yeah, benefit of a strongly type helper is for the validation and for, you know, generating the controls based on the, you know, the defined class properties. In upcoming classes, I will explain all the things in detail about the strongly type helper and the validation. Don't worry. So guys, if you will see here, we have a form action. Can you see my browser? Okay, let me share the browser. So guys, can you see my browser? I hope now you can see. Okay, yeah, enum you can convert into the drop down list. There is no issue. Now guys, if you will see in the browser, we have a form action and we have a form method. And if you will see, we have here a input type text box, and this text box ID is username and name is username. So guys, can you tell me which attribute is responsible for posting this username text box value on the server side, and even this password text box value on the server side, ID and name? Guys, tell me which attribute is used to post this form value on the server side, ID and name. Say some people are saying ID and some people are saying name. So now guys, if you are from the background of ASP.NET web form, so I know your answer would be here ID, but it is not correct. The correct answer is here name. Only name attribute is responsible for posting your input control value on the server side. The ID attribute is responsible to uniquely identify your element on the client side so that you can manipulate that element on the client side using jQuery and using JavaScript. So if you will not specify the name attribute for your input control, you cannot access the value. And you know guys, this is a HTML rule and it is everywhere. It doesn't matter whether you are using MVC, Java and webform, everywhere it is same. If you remember in case of webform, we have the same concept in webform as well. In webform, whatever the, you know, the ID we specify for our server controls, with the same value, we have the name attribute as well. I don't know guys, in HTML, we post our input control value using the form tag. So same thing we are doing here. So guys, here, this form is responsible for posting that these input controls value on the server side. So there is a submit button if you will see. And you guys, submit button default behavior is to submit its form data on the server side. And you know, guys, where the form will submit the data? The form will submit the data on this section. If you will see, we have the option for action. So if you will see in our controller, we have the action, we have the home controller here, and we have, you know, the index section, if you will see. And this index section, I have not specified for, you know, accepting the post request. Because you will see in my form, the method name is post here, simple. So what we have to do, we have to create an action with the name index in the home controller, and method should be here post. And here we will receive the value for this username, and where we will receive the value for password. And here the name attribute is responsible for posting the value. So now it's time to create one more action with the name index in the home controller. And there we will use the post method. So let's see. So let's use the post method here. Simple. So I'm going to create the one more action for receiving my input control value. So just use here http post. And you know, guys, whatever the, you know, the text box name we have, so those text box name we can receive as a action parameter, like a string user name, a string password, this way. And now here we will write, we will receive the value. Let's see. And you guys, here I have decorated this action with HTTP post because my method, my form method is post. I know, guys, in the form we have two methods, get and post. So right now we are using the post method for posting the form data on the server side. You know, guys, when I'm talking about the controller name, in controller name, we don't have the controller word. We have only first thing, home. So home is a correct name for the home controller. Controller word never counted as a name for the controller. So now when I will pass the username, let's say Shailendra, password, I'm passing like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now click on the login button. So how we will receive the thing? You will get the username as Shailendra. I'm getting password. I'm getting here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So in this way, you can receive the value on the server side. And here I'm using the HTTP post method. Simple. But you know, guys, if you want to use here method get, I can use get method as well for posting the data. So guys, can you tell me the difference between get method and the post method? Yeah, guys, please reply. What is the difference between get method and the post method if you are putting on your HTML form? Yeah, guys, when you will use the post method, then data will be sent to the server side as a request body. And when you will use the get method, the data will be posted on the server side as a request URL query string. So here get is not recommended. Post is recommended. Get you can use if you want to pass the simple information like page number, like sorting column, sorting direction. So such type of information you can pass using the get method. But if you are passing the like credit card information, password, all these things we should pass using the post method. Simple. So let's see how we can change our method. So I can do here, I can specify like my index is my action name would be here. Controller name would be here home, and the form method will be here like get. In this way, we can specify the form method as get now. And if you will see here right now, I'm using the action name as my index. So this my index, I will specify in my home controller. Ranjit, I'm just showing you the way how to use the get method. It is not mandatory to use the get method. We will use every time post method. I'm just showing you the difference between these two so that you can understand the concept. Simple. Anything else you want to ask? So now let's see how we will call the myIndex method. And this time we are using the get. You know guys, by default, any action in MVC, you can call using get and the post verb. So can you skip the HTTP get declaration? It is not mandatory. So by default, I can call using the get verb here. If there is no issue. Password 123456. So you can see I'm getting the username as Shelly and the password as 123456. If you will see, we have the username and the password now it is exposing as a query string of the URL. So this is the difference between get method and the post method in HTML form. So guys, do you have any query regarding this HTML form and how we are receiving the value on the server side and how the get and the post method are working? Yeah guys, you can use other verb as well, like HTTP port and HTTP delete. Another verb generally we use if you want to call the things using, you know, jQuery like Angular. So if you are making a put, delete, post and get request using Angular and jQuery, you can use those verb. Yeah guys, you can have the multiple submit button within this begin form. And even here I can write that different code as well. Like when I will click on the login button, it will do the different processing. When I will click on the, you know, sign up button, it will do the different processing. In the upcoming classes, I will tell you how to handle the multiple button click event. So guys, do you have any query so far? So can we proceed? Okay. Guys, we will share the video, don't worry. If you want to set the get and the post at runtime, so in that case, you have to use either jQuery, either Angular. Choosing the jQuery, you can decide the method get and post on the runtime. So when you will click on the button, so just capture this button click using jQuery or JavaScript and then decide how you want to post that form dynamically easy, either using get verb, either using post verb. Anything else you want to ask? Okay guys, let's see if we want to include here. The Angular in this project. So how we can include the Angular? So now guys, for including the Angular, what you have to do? You have to refer the official document provided by the, you know, the Angular team. How we can include the method. So here there is an official document to integration with Visual Studio, like Angular to setup with Visual Studio 2015. So there is an official document by the Angular team, like how to configure it VS Code. You can see here, they have given the step you can follow. And even they have given the, you know, the quick start source as well. So this is the step one you have to use. So just download this source code and just extract all the file in this zip folder. So this is a GitHub reference. From there you have to download this zip file. So in my system, I have already downloaded this zip file. From that zip file, I will copy the some files so that I can configure the Angular with my MVC. So let's see how we can configure it. So I'm just opening that folder directly here. So this is the downloaded folder from the GitHub. And guys, let's see how we can configure the Angular with MVC. So here we have to copy some files, not all the. Let's copy the TS lint file, then use here package.json file. So these two files you have to copy only and put this file and the application label. I'm putting here as a paste option. And now if you will see in the package.json, you will get whatever the package are required for the Angular. If you will see here, it is using the Angular 4. So these packages we have to install. And you guys, for installing these packages, make sure you have to install the Node.js on your machine. So for downloading the Node.js, you have to go to the Node.js.org. From here, you have to download the Node.js LTS release. So this Node.js I have already installed here. Okay. Modit here, the karma and the protected. We use for writing the unit test cases for Angular. Today I'm not writing the unit test cases for Angular. That's why I have not included. So if you want to write the unit test cases for Angular application, you can use karma. And here I'm just adding a folder for my client side code. So just do one thing, just add a folder with the name client. I'm adding a folder with the name client, like client. And this client folder, whatever the code we have in SRC folder. So this entire code we will put in this client folder. So just copy each and every file from the client folder and put here. Let's say paste. So all the things we have put in now in this client folder. And now, you know, guys, it's up to you whether you want to put all the Angular references either on the master page, either on the, you know, specific page. Okay. So guys, here I'm just showing the way how I can configure the Angular with MVC. So just do one thing. You know, guys, in Angular, we have a index.html file. So this is the main file which we will use to configure, or you can see to initialize the Angular application here. So whatever the, you know, the script references we have on this index.html and whatever we have in this body section, all these we have to put on the master page so that on each and every page we can use Angular syntax with my MVC views. Simple. Guys, here LTS is, you know, current version means it is right now in development. LTS means it is stable release. So all the modules, whatever we have in market right now, they must have support with the LTS release. But with the current release, they might not have the support. So sometimes we need a module which has the support to a specific Node.js version. So LTS is more stable as compared to the current one. So that's why the recommended is use the LTS. Don't use the current one, because sometimes we use a module for doing the different tasks, like converting the page into the PDF, converting the page into the Excel. In that case, the LTS will help you. So guys, here just copy all these script from here and put on the master page. So just open underscore layout here and put all the things here. I'm putting all the things here, simple. And whatever the jQuery references we have just cut from here and put at the top level, simple. And you guys, we will see. Now we have to install the node modules. So node modules are just like, you know, we have them been in .NET. Same way we have the node modules for the Angular. So in the package.json, if you have, you know, Visual Studio 17, so just do right click and you will have the option for restore packages. So when you will select the restore package option, it automatically restore all the Node.js packages and put into the node underscore modules. So I'm restoring all the packages. And you know, guys, make sure you are connected with the internet. If you are not connected with the internet, it will not download the node packages. So now it is, you can see it is installing the Node.js packages, whatever we have in package.json. So all these node packages, it is going to install in my node underscore module folder. Simple. So you can check there is a folder with the name node underscore module. So far it's not created, we will create. Let's wait. Because it is working on installation. So as soon it will install, it will do the things. So far, just do one thing, just do the necessary changes in the relative part, because now we have the all the things in this client folder. So from this client folder to we are adding the things on this shared folder underscore layout. So now there is a change in the relative path. So relative path would be here now, like slash this way. And for system.js config, the relative path is client. So just use here client slash system.js config. And here this main.ts file will be converted into the main.js. So this path I have to change. So it will be here client this way. So now I'm just doing the changes as per my relative path. So now this will be a client slash main.js, and it will be also the client slash system.js config. And even also there is a file here system.js config. Now I can remove this index.html. And here we have to do one more setting. Just specify the base href. So this base href we have to specify here. Simple. Now just remove this index.html. Simple. And just open the system.js config. And here also we have to do the change in relative path. It is here, you know, client slash system.js angular loader. And here also we have to do the change. It should be here client slash app this way. So we have to do the changes only the relative path in system.js.config and on this underscore layout page. That's it. Only these changes you have to do on the relative path. Simple. And in the meanwhile, it has installed all the node.js module. We can verify. Okay, if there is a spelling mistake. Okay. There is a spelling mistake. Client slash app. And make sure we don't have here. Okay. Guys, so far we don't have main.js in the client folder. This main.js file will be created when the Visual Studio will compile this TypeScript file. Because whatever the code we will write in the TypeScript file, it will be compiled by the Visual Studio into the plain JS. So no guys, the browser cannot understand the TypeScript. Browser can understand only JavaScript. So all the TS file we have to compile into the plain JS. So this file you will get on the runtime. Anything else you want to ask here? And so far it is installing the packages. Hey guys, CodeLens is a features in Visual Studio Enterprise Edition for, you know, debugging your code in better way. Anything else you want to ask? So guys, if you have any queries so far, please ask. Because right now it is downloading all the node modules from the server. That is, you can see it is in progress. And now guys, if you will see here, there is a app module. So this app module is, you know, just like we have, you know, this is the main module for our application. So this app module must have the information about all the, you know, building blocks of our Angular application. You can see here, there is an import option. In the import option, we are importing the browser built-in module so that we have the support for Angular in browser. This is the, you know, the component. So component are here just like you, we have the, you know, pages in MVC. And this is the, you know, the startup component. As we have set the startup page in route config, same way we are setting the startup component here. So this is the app module we have here. And if you will see here, we have here app component. So app component is just like, you know, we have a page in or MVC. So this is the, you know, the just like the controller as we have in MVC, and this is just like the view we have in MVC. So whatever the, you know, the members we are defining in this class, these member we can access in this template. So here I have specified the template as, this is the inline template I'm defining. Even here as a template, you can render any HTML file as well. So if you want to render any HTML file, we can do. Guys, here the Angular routing will work on the client side and MVC routing will work on the server side. In upcoming classes, we will show you like how we'll do the both the routing. So guys, here right now I'm using here inline template, but I will show you how we can use as a other HTML file. So now just build the application. If all the Node.js modules has been, you know, downloaded successfully, it will build it successfully. Now it is saying there is no module for Angular/core. It means it has not installed the Angular modules so far. So now restore the things again, because so far it's not added the node_module folder. It's added, but there is a missing of the module. You can see it's downloading all the packages here this way. It is showing you the installation process of node modules. And now guys, here what I can do, sometimes it takes time. These, you know, the modules you can also install by using the, you know, the node.js command prompt. So what you can do, you can open this folder location here. So this is my folder location. So now just this folder location I can open in my node.js command prompt, like cd and the this location f and colon this way. And here I can run the command for installing the, you can see here node modules are installed successfully. Now there is no issue. You can see all the modules are available here. If these are not installed from here, what you can do using this node.js command prompt, you can also install the node module by running the command node install. Only this command you have to run. If you don't have the option for restoring the packages in your Visual Studio, but in my case it is already installed, so I don't need to run this command. I'm just building my project. Now it will be built successfully. Yeah guys, we have so many file in node_modules, but these will not be the part of the publish folder. Don't worry, because this folder is already hidden. So whatever the files we have in this node_modules folder are not the part of the solution file. The environment variable you don't need to set here at all. But make sure you have to install, you have installed the node.js on your machine. After installing the node.js on the machine, you can do the things. Simple. The Angular error you can see in the Visual Studio. Now you can see now it is building successfully. And now what I have to do? I have to specify, let's say I'm going to create a one more controller. Let's say I'm going to create a app controller. MVC5 app controller I'm using. And this app controller I will set as a start page for my Angular application. Simple. So here, whatever the, you know, the component we have, that component I will render here. So in client folder, we have the option how to call the component. So in app component, we have the selector my-app. So this selector we have to copy and put here my app. and this will be here like Angular loading, simple. So this is MVC razor page this way, and here now I have added my Angular component tag so that I can access it. And now in app underscore start, just set the startup page from home to app, simple. So I have set as a startup page from home to app. Now run the things. If everything is fine, if your Angular setup is perfect, you will get the Angular as well as MVC message on the same browser page. Let's see. So you can see here, I'm getting the MVC razor, and after some time, it's giving the message here, hello Angular. So from where we are getting the hello Angular, in there is a app component, and here we have H1 tag with the name hello, and this is the name Angular I'm getting. So from here, I'm getting the hello Angular. So in this way, we have included the Angular with our ASP.NET MVC 5 project, simple. And even we can add other things as well, like if you want to define a text box here, say text box you can define here. So what I can do, I can add a div here. So I can add a div here, and in this div I can put a text box like input type text. And now guys, even instead of writing the inline template, at the recommended ways you should create a HTML page. So let's create a HTML page, and that HTML page we will render here. So just add a HTML page here, app.component.html, and from here we can put the Angular template. So just cut from here and put the things. Now here in place of template, we will use the template URL. So just use here template URL, template URL, and as a template URL just specify the app component. Just path you have to specify, app component dot html path you have to specify. Now it will render this HTML in place of this inline template. So now the entire code you have to write in app component dot html. So I can write the text box here like input type text, and for 2-way data binding I can use here like ng model. Let's say ng model, and you can use here the name, simple. So this will bind my text box value based on the, you know, the value in my app component TS. So whatever the name I will set, it will set there as well. So I'm putting here like .NET tricks MVC5 with Angular. So this will show this name. So now let's run the program again, and you will get the output. Yeah, Mudit, in case of template URL, you can specify a CSS HTML page as well. In that case, you have to specify the URL there. I will show you how you can render a CSS HTML page, and even the ASPX you can render. Okay, it will see it is showing the error like cannot bind the ng model since it is not a known property of input. I'm getting this error. The reason is I have not added the module reference for using the ng model. So there is a module in Angular that module reference we have to add in this app module. So here I have to add a Angular built-in module for using the form. So there is a module here, forms, and we have to use here forms module. So this forms module we have to import at app module here. Now you can use the ng model. Otherwise you cannot use the ng model. Now run the things. So you can see here I'm getting the output here hello .NETX MVC with Angular. And if I will do the changes here like MVC with Angular training program, you will get the updated value here directly. So in this way, as soon as you will type the things in the text box, it will shown here. Simple. So in this way, we can combine the Angular with our MVC this way. Yeah, these modules are, you know, just like we added the namespace at the class level as a reference. Same way you have to add these modules using the import statement as a reference so that your Angular application can use. So guys, this is the training program agenda here. So these are the technology we are going to cover in this training program. We will cover here the latest version of ASP.NET MVC5. We will cover link, entity framework, dependency injection, repository design pattern, and unit of work design pattern. So now guys, what are the design patterns people are using while developing the ASP.NET MVC application? So all the recommended design patterns we are following here. So we are covering here the four design pattern: MVC, dependency injection, repository, and unit of work. We will cover here web API for developing the REST services. And in the web API, I will tell you how to implement the token-based security. And in MVC, how to implement the role-based security. We will cover here TypeScript as well, because for learning the Angular, you must know the TypeScript. And in the meanwhile, you will get some mockup tests as well from our side. So mockup test objective is to check your learning progress. And the assignment objective is to develop the small tasks independently so that you have the confidence to work independently here. Simple. So these are the things we are going to cover here. And then finally, we will develop a e-commerce website as well. Because until you will not develop a website, a project, you will not have the idea how to use MVC and Angular together. So this is the project architecture we will follow in this training program. So you can see here, I will create the DEL layer using entity framework code first approach. I will create the bell layer using the repository design pattern. And here I will use the domain models for entities and view models. And in the presentation layer side, we will use Angular 4, MVC 5, and the C#. And this is the REST API we will develop here. So this is the project architecture we will follow in this training program. And what we will do in this project, we will create the shopping cart using Angular 4. We will do the integration of payment gateway. We will create here DEL layer using entity framework code first approach. In the bell layer, we will implement the repository design pattern, unit of work, and dependency injection as well. We will develop here different modules using areas. We will, you know, create the service layer using web API. We will do the scaling of our application for the phone, tablet, laptop, and desktop. And here we will do the error logging as well using Alma. And I will tell you how to improve the page performance and how to secure the application based on the roles here. These things we will develop. And for the authorization and authentication, we will use here ASP.NET MVC custom filters. So I will tell you how to use the filters in MVC for authentication and authorization. We will apply here token-based security and web API. And finally, we will publish it on the IS. And you know, guys, if you need other information, you can follow the link here, .netrix.com/training/mvc-angular-js-development. This link you can follow. Even you can make a call to us as well. So guys, for today class, I have done from my side. If you have any query, you can ask. Yeah, guys, do you have any query regarding this training program? If you have any query, please ask. Yeah, guys, all the session recording you will get. Whatever I will teach you, you will get the recording of each and every session. If you're talking about the course fee, you can check this link and even you can write us an email regarding the same. So you will get all the information regarding the, you know, the enrollment. So our course advisor will help you like how to enroll into this training program. So guys, anything else you want to ask? Yeah, Pankaj, I told here I will implement here token based security, and this token we will pass from Angular to Web API. And in the Web API side, I will check the first of all whether the user is logged in or not. Then I will check the user permission so that I can authenticate and authorize the user on the server side. So security we will cover here. Anything else you want to ask? So guys, I hope you have enjoyed the session. So this is from my side for today's session. If you have any query, any doubt, you can ask. And guys, please share the feedback of this session as well, because it is valuable for us. So don't forget to share your valuable feedback, how you feel about this session. And you know, guys, we have the plan such type of session in future as well. So we'll get other session as well from our side, like on ASP.NET Core, Xamarin, React, Cloud Computing. All these sessions we will do in upcoming session as well. I told here we will share the session video. Don't worry. We will have, make sure you have mentioned your proper email ID when you have joined the meeting. So that email ID we will use for sharing the session. So guys, anything else you want to ask? Okay guys, thank you.